Hello and welcome to another edition of the Sacramento Dugout Show. I'm Todd Sullivan. I'm here with my co-host Dominic Morris. Today we have a special guest, Mr. Harvey Hargrove. How are you, sir?
Doing good. Thanks for having me.
Harvey is a graduate of a Cordova High School. He is also in the Cordova High Hall of Fame. He was with Guy Anderson when he won his fifth 500th victory. But more importantly, 1997, sixth round major league draft pick.
Right.
How did that feel when you got that phone call, my friend?
Man, it felt real good. It was one, when I went into a baseball field about 12 years old, I didn't know if I'd really get. It's one of those things where it's a dream of yours of playing the major leagues. But for me, I wanted to be a high school coach and coach baseball. For me, major leagues, it seemed a little bit further off. But to have your name called that early, for me, I was happy with the top 20 rounds and to get my name called in the sixth round. It was an honor, and I feel like it's some hard work paid off for me.
Take us through the process, because a lot of people here, you get drafted in the sixth round, but in baseball, you know, there's the farm system. There's steps that you got to get to, you know, to ultimate level. So as an 18-year-old, 19-year-old, you know, young man getting drafted, how was it like being away from your family, different foreign city, and just having baseball as your job every day?
Gotcha. So recently, you guys just had Guy Anderson on. I actually lived with him my senior year of high school. A lot of people don't know it. My dad was in the military. He was stationed at Mather Air Force Base. All the Cordova kids went there. And it came to my senior year right before my dad got transferred to North Carolina, and Coach Anderson right away wanted to house me and keep me there. So I think a lot of the travel part I was prepared for, as far as being away from family, being away from friends. At 17, I was away from my mom, my dad. They moved back to the East Coast, and I stayed with Coach Anderson. So being a military brat, moving every 2 to 3 years, sometimes 3 to 4 years, I've been in Southern California, Germany, North Carolina, South Carolina, a bunch of different places, and with baseball, places in between that as well. So for me, the travel part, being away from family for a weekend, a month, 6 months for a minor league season, that wasn't the adjustment that I don't think that I needed to make. My adjustment was more on the field. Not really work ethic, but knowing how to get myself right again when I was struggling, I'd say more than anything.
So interesting. So being in the military, having a military family and traveling throughout and not being, you know, settling your roots down. When you were overseas and you were out of the States, what sports were you were playing over there?
So basketball from about 5 or 6 years old till I was 12. And for me, I think I played T-ball when I was 8 years old, if I'm not mistaken. Baseball wasn't something I was interested in as far as playing. I liked watching it. Baseball for me was home run derby with my brother with tennis balls and racquetballs. Really, we'd have a lot of space in between the houses on base, and I just try and hit it as far as I could. So at 12 years old, when I finally walked onto the baseball field, for me it was a welcoming thing because my dad had been my coach the whole time. I would go into timeouts in high school when he wasn't my coach. I was having conversations with him rather than having conversations with my coach and my teammates. So it got to a point to me where dad didn't know much about baseball. And it was a place for kind of like a way of escape. And then shortly after that, of course, he thinks he knows everything about baseball. But it was one of those things for me where it was new. It was something that I felt like I was pretty good at right away. And I think a lot of things translate when I look at players now. A young athlete that can move his feet pretty good on a basketball court, I think, translates to a baseball field. I just think it has to be cultivated in a certain way. So, again, going back to me being away from the game of baseball for 15 years before starting some of the stuff I'm doing now, I think that young players need to know themselves more than they may think they do. It's more than coach talking to them. It's more than mom and dad talking to them. It's them getting to know themselves. Anything I do one-on-one or small group, that's what I do. I'm pulling from them to know how I can help them. My journey in the minor leagues basically finished with me having the Seattle Mariners in my mind tell me that I wasn't good enough to play the game. So it was hard for me. It was something that I struggled with. But it's something after a lot of time, being away from the game like I have, it helped me to know what I have to do to help the youth that I'm working with now.
So when you're first, when people were contacting you about maybe there is a draft process and you were going to be a part of it, I mean, I'm sitting, as far as I'm concerned, to one of the best center fielders, and I know you're shortstop, second base, center fielder. So when you were taking that, being looked at and drafted, were you looking at an infielder in the middle, or were you one of those Willie Mays center fielder guys?
Not really.
What was the scouts? No, so getting you to get to position wise.
So for me, I was looked at as a middle infielder, and the interesting thing that with Seattle, I thought was going to happen, didn't happen. So the second baseman that got drafted in front of me, Jermaine Clark, he's pretty local, went to Willsey Wood, he's from Vacaville, has some big league time. Most of the teams in the area, we played against each other in high school, we played against each other in college. He went to USF, I went to Sac State. Every team was working us out together. So we went Braves workout, A's workout, Seattle workout. Seattle's the only team that had me throw from the outfield because I played there probably about 30 or 40 games my sophomore year at Sac State because we brought in another shortstop and I was better for the outfield at that point. So it helped me become a center fielder later, but I was looked at as a middle infielder with every team except for Seattle. So of course, I'm thinking, all right, they drafted Jermaine ahead of me in the fifth round. I'm probably moving to the outfield, and I end up playing third base, which is completely different. I had never played there. The field wasn't that great, and anyone that's an infielder knows that guys in the middle like to use their feet. Going to a reactionary position was a little bit tough for me, and a learning. There was a learning curve there that I struggled with, to be honest with you. And along with that struggle comes other things in the minor leagues when everyone is as good as you are and they're looking polished and you're thinking, same thing with Jermaine Clark. When we're going to these workouts, I'm thinking, all right, if I end up with this team, you're already looking at the list. All right, this guy's in the big leagues. This guy's in AA. This guy's in AAA. We look at the Seattle Mariners, shortstop, second base, center field, A-Rod, Griffey Jr., and at that time, Brett Boone, who was tearing the cover off the ball. So you already know that there's a hard road ahead. So you start seeing people get picked up in the Rule 5 draft and things like that. And it doesn't end up happening because A-Rod and Griffey get traded. You empty out Cincinnati and the Astros and the Rangers farm system. And you kind of get pushed out of the wash. So that's where I think even for high school and young age, I'm sure we're going to get on some academy and travel ball things too. The game of high school baseball, and I'm not sure if Guy spoke about it last week. The game of high school baseball to me has changed quite a bit too.
Yeah, I coach high school baseball. Okay. We've talked about it. Changed definitely. A lot for sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And another question I want to ask, I know, you know, Ryan Royster.
Yes.
Yeah, I know you know him. Mm-hmm. The Sacramento baseball is a mecca. I mean, there's so much talent that has come out for decades. Mm-hmm. And what's really unique about Sacramento, I'm not sure about how they fit together, but it seems like the Milwaukee Brewers, the Padres, and the Seattle Mariners seem to be where a lot of the Sacramento people are picked up from. I mean, they don't stay there, but it seems like that's the main base.
It does seem that
working with scouts, in the Sacramento region, is there a particular group that tends to stay in a certain area?
You know, that's a good question. I couldn't speak directly to that. I think Larry Harper was my scout with Seattle back then. It seems like along with them, the Yankees and the Giants were in Sacramento. I remember being in high school, but I'm not sure. Yeah. But I'm not sure exactly.
That's where I was going next.
Gotcha,
because it seems to be real generation, because you got Greg Vaughn in the 80s. Mm-hmm. You had the Brewers and the Giants. I mean, that was just like Sacramento was getting picked up. You know, the 60s, it was the A's when you're dealing with Sammy Lovelace and things like that that were coming through. You know, in the 90s, it started doing the Padres and going into Colorado was a big thing. But the one thing that I know, like the Oakland base, they always have the scouts that tend to really focus in the Northern California area. Mm-hmm. Just like, you know, the Florida, they have their scouts that sit because they're big baseball communities. Mm-hmm. And you got Ryan, who is now a player agent.
Right.
You know, so how do you feed I know you're coaching youth and you're dealing with academies and that's where the kids want to go. How do you keep their train of thought, you know, on the day-by-day path instead of big jumps down the future?
I think that's a tough part with youth sports in general. Just speaking to the game of baseball, we've all heard the term daddy ball before. Travel ball, I don't think academies are bad. I think academies can be a good thing if they're teaching the game properly. I think the bad thing comes in the travel ball where I played against two or three teams last year that won't exist this season for my 14-year-olds or 13, and there's going to be three or four more new teams. So I think kids end up getting tossed around from place to place, and everyone's different. I may be saying the exact same thing to you, to your hitters, hitting-wise, but you may say it to them for them to grasp it better. I think they may need you, they may need me at some point.
The more verbiage, the better.
Exactly. So I just think for me, the hard part is just if you want to get better every day, that should be your focus. You want to be a baseball player? I just asked my team. We lost a tournament on Sunday this week, 6-4, pretty good team out of Vacaville. And we gave up in the fourth, fifth, and sixth inning, I told them on Tuesday night. Seventh inning, one out, we end up with our best hitter up with runners at second and third. He strikes out on a 2-2 pitch. Mm-hmm. But fourth, fifth, and sixth inning, where was that team in the seventh inning? I think they have a tendency of things being redundant. I go to practice on Tuesday and Thursday, so I'm going to go through the motions, not worry about going, getting better, and you have to get better every day. That's one thing that I tell all the youth I work with. I want to be who I think that I needed when I was playing the game.
Yeah, just wrapping it up, we want to talk about your program that you got implemented. Tell a little about it. Seek baseball?
Seek first. So seek first? Obviously, there is some baseball terminology in there. You want to get on first base, but it's a little bit more multifaceted than that. Faith-based, seeking first the kingdom of God is one thing that I think I want my family to come first and foremost. And for me, as an extension of outside of the four corners of my home, to be able to reach out to the community. We were talking about it a little bit before we went on, we used to play pickup baseball. We used to go outside and ride our bikes to the park, and it didn't matter what the field looked like, we played. So it's one thing that I tried to add. I call it the Seek Lot. Kind of spin off of Sandlot, just had his 25-year anniversary. I just want a place where whatever travel team you play for, whatever academy you go to, come and get better, work on your skills. I don't know everything.
And where can we find more information about your program?
Definitely hit me up on Instagram. I'm on there, Seek First Sports, SEEK, the number 1ST Sports. Facebook, I'm Seek First Sports. Twitter, Seek First Sports. And you can follow me there and all my information and everything that I'm doing.
Awesome.
Nice. And so when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about Academy Baseball. We'll do our Around the Horn segment right after these messages.
With Harvey Hargrove, currently Best B baseball instructor and founder of Seek First Initiative for Baseball. I do want to talk to you about pickup baseball. You grew up playing that to Academy Baseball.
Right.
And how your initiative goes into like bringing back that authentic style of baseball.
Right. So for me, I think the way travel ball works, as I spoke before, there's a new team every month or so. If you don't like how things are going one place, you can go find somewhere else to do it. And I think you have to be honest in a situation. If your kid's not getting better in a travel ball situation or an academy situation, either that sport's not for him or it's not being taught to him right. And I think that's the issue with travel ball teams more than academies, because typically academies do have some instructors where if everyone on the staff doesn't know how to do everything, you have a couple of instructors that can filter that information down. But if you just had, again, a daddy ball dad that was upset and, you know what, Johnny, let's go build our team, you're gonna be my shortstop, and we just add some more of their friends, you may end up missing out on vital information, because dad's never played baseball to where when I came back into this game a year and a half ago, I had 15-year-olds, freshmen and sophomores in high school, 14, 15, that didn't even pick each other up. They would leave their teammates hanging. So you miss out on a lot.
Competition level. Where's the competition level? Right. I mean, if you want to get better, you need to play at a better competition. What I like my kids in high school, I tell them during the summer, if you're 13, 14, go play with the 15 and 16 years old. If you're 15 and 16, go play with the 17
Absolutely.
And 18-year-old. Play at the game at the faster speed if you really want to get better when you're not around the coaches, when you're playing in fall, when you're playing in the summer. Take that opportunity so you can grow. But you also do the Show California baseball as well.
I did. So I did Show California for about 8 months, went to Best Speed, and I coach the Seek First Hawks. It's a team in Natomas right now.
Okay, so that's my main focus is, you know, coming into this community, you know, you being playing at the level that you played at and being coached by some of the best coaches around. Mm-hmm. the way you give back to the community is commendable. I want to thank you for one, because that's basically what I'm all about, is giving back to the kids. That's why I run my free clinic on Sundays. It's just a lot of the parents can't afford clinics. They can't get the professional athletes like we can get to come out and teach them. Cost too much. We always find the opportunity to give back to the kids. And I just want to say thank you, because I've seen you coach. I've seen you out there working with the kids. And it's you don't treat it as a job. I think you're one of the kids out there. You're one of the bigger kids with all the knowledge.
Right. And it's funny. That's how I look at it, to be honest. I still play video games with them. They'll show me, they put it on me on MLB The Show and end up losing because it's the same thing. They don't take baseball. For me, when you're playing me in PlayStation, I tell them all the time, don't play video games, play baseball. Sometimes they don't know where to be on the baseball field. Guess what the game shows them? A double cut. I've had kids tell me they didn't know what a double cut was. But I think it's just attention to detail. And I think that I can relate to them because I've been where they are right now. I've been there where they want to go. And I know how to and not to go about ways of doing certain things. So that's what I'm trying to get back to them through everything I do. Like I say, I try to do different areas where I call it the seek a lot, and whatever team, whatever organization, whatever age, like you, I don't mind having some 10 and 11 year olds with the 15s and 16s, because they're watching what they're doing and it's going to make them better players.
Yeah, exactly. Any last messages you want to leave to our crowd?
For sure, man. I just say anyone here in Sacramento doing baseball, Alex Smith said this the other day, who I work with at Best Speed, is more collaboration and less going around trying to do everything yourself. You don't have to charge an arm and a leg for everything. I know that you could if you wanted to. Just look at trying to make the game of baseball better and try to make these kids better. I just want to be able to pass on something to the next generation of baseball to carry on. That's more than travel ball, that's more than academies and more than trophies, it's just the love of baseball and being out there.
Alex created a great program over there. When he first started, it was very small. Mm-hmm. He was relying on friends of his as well as himself, and the people that he's brought in and year out, including yourself. There's a lot, you know, 99 problems in pitching one, with a lot of flavor.
Absolutely.
And just to see the passion from every coach, just to see the character of every coach, the craziness, the loving, the kindness. I think you guys got a great family over there, and we really appreciate you coming on the show.
Appreciate it, man.
Thank you again for what you do to the community, and I know we'll be seeing each other. I got a couple of my boys over there right now.
For sure.
So, you know,
that's
we'll be
there. It for the Sac Dugout Show. We out of time. Thanks, Harvey, for being on. Catch us next week on the Sac Dugout Show.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.